Good morning to one and all present here. I am Ms. Sanjukta Soni, working as Assistant Professor, School of Pharmacy, Parul University. I feel privileged to extend my greetings to respected Dr. M.N. Patel, Provost, Parul University, Abhay Dharmasi Sir, Dean, Faculty of Pharmacy, Dr. G.S. Chakravarti Sir, Principal, Parul University of Pharmacy and Research, Dr. Lata Jha Madam, Principal, School of Pharmacy, and Dr. Preeti Verma Madam, Lecturer in Pharmacognosy at LM College of Pharmacy, Ahmedabad, all faculty members and my dear students. On behalf of Faculty of Pharmacy, Parul University, I welcome you all, the distinguished dignitary, to grace the online national level webinar on pharmacovigilance of herbal medicines. Now, it's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Preeti Verma Madam. So Dr. Preeti Verma Madam is presently a lecturer in pharmacognosy at LM College of Pharmacy, Ahmedabad. She has done her B.Pharm in 2006 and M.Pharm in pharmacognosy in 2008 from the LM Pharmacy College only. She has also obtained doctorate degree from Hem Chandracharya North Gujarat University, Patan in 2016. She had started her career as an assistant professor at Parul University of Pharmacy, Vadodara, where she served for 2 years. Afterwards, she started offering services to her alma mater, LMCP. Dr. Verma has around 13 years of experience in academic field. She has published 18 research papers and review articles in reputed journals, and has also co-authored 2 pharmacognosy books for B.Pharm syllabus. She has contributed as a co-PI in development of pharmacopeial monograph on single drugs of Remdesivir, a project grant from Pharmacopoeia Council of Indian Medicine and Homeopathy, Ministry of Ayush, Government of India. She has presently contributing as a mentor for 4 research projects granted by Student Startup and Innovation Policy, SSIP, LMCP, Gujarat. She has a recipient of Shri Devendra C. Patel Gold Medal to top rank in M.Pharm pharmacognosy subject by Gujarat University in 2009. She had also received Best Oral Paper Presentation Award at 12th Annual National Convention of Indian Society of Pharmacognosy held at Punjab in 2008. She also has 3 Best Poster Presentation Award to her credit and was selected among top 10 innovative idea prizes at SSIP competition held at LMCP in 2020. Her areas of interest include standardization of herbal drugs, development of monographs for indigenous medicinal plants, phytopharmacological studies of medicinal plants, bioactivity, guided extraction and isolation of marker compounds, and development of nutraceutical formulation. So now I request Dr. Preeti Verma Madam to begin the session. Madam, this session is over to you.
Thank you, Sanjogita, for the nice introduction. Very good morning to one and all. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Lalit Lata Jha Ma'am, the Principal, School of Pharmacy, for giving me such a wonderful opportunity to share my views and express my knowledge regarding this topic on the platform. So thank you so much, Parul University. The topic of my talk is pharmacovigilance in herbal medicines. But for the students who are not aware of pharmacovigilance topic, I will be starting with a brief introduction of general pharmacovigilance, what adverse events are, what are ADRs, what was the need of pharmacovigilance, which are the scopes. Then we will move on to our main topic, that is herbal pharmacovigilance, its definition, why it is needed, what are the possible causes of adverse drug reactions due to herbal medicine use, which are the challenges, and in very brief, we will again see the regulatory aspects of herbal pharmacovigilance and PVPI program of India. To begin with, I would like to start the session with a quote from Molière, who was a French drama writer. He quoted rightly that to undergo treatment, you have to be very healthy, because apart from your sickness, you have to withstand the medicine. People are nowadays denying the use of medicine because of the side effects. They say that we will bear the discomfort caused by the disease rather than the side effects of the medicine. So drug safety had always been the matter of concern for the healthcare professionals and for the consumers, and still it is a matter of big concern. So pharmacovigilance, it is derived from two words, pharmakon and vigilare. Pharmakon in Greek means a drug, and vigilare means to keep watch or to keep eye or monitor. So in short, pharmakon is monitoring of the drug. Now, what kind of monitoring is done here is rightly defined in the WHO definition, that pharmacovigilance is the science and activities dealing with the detection, assessment, understanding, and prevention of adverse events or any drug-related problems. So we are monitoring the drug-related adverse events in pharmacovigilance. Pharmacovigilance is generally started from the beginning phases of the medical trials or clinical trials till the end when the drug is marketed into the common public. Several events we will terms we will come across, that is adverse event. Adverse event means any unwanted medical occurrence that may present during the treatment with the drug but may not be having any causal direct relationship with the treatment itself or the drug itself. While ADR, adverse drug reaction, is a type of adverse event which is unwanted, harmful, which occurs after the administration of the drug under normal condition in normal doses, and it is suspected to have causal relationship with the drug. When we say serious adverse event or serious ADR, it means the reactions which are causing threaten to the life, which cause hospitalization or which increase the time of hospitalization or which may cause disability or misuse or dependence or finally the death of the patient. For example, calcium channel blockers and phenytoin, they are causing gingival hyperplasia, enlargement of the gums, which if increased to a certain level, it may lead to death of the patient also. Same way, comerin, that is warfarin induced necrosis of the lung due to excessive hemorrhage caused by the overdose of the comedins. If we see the prevalence and occurrence of ADRs globally, ADR is considered to be the fourth largest cause of morbidity and mortality in healthcare. Out of all the 98,000 deaths that occur every year due to medical errors, 6 to 7% are due to the serious adverse drug reactions only, and these are increasing exponentially due to the increased use of medicines. But the good news is 30 to 60% of the serious adverse drug reactions are preventable if we monitor them at the right time and in the right way. So there comes the need of pharmacovigilance for promoting the rational and safe use of all types of medicine to offer the best patient care and patient safety. If I summarize the need of pharmacovigilance in three reasons, then the reason number one will be the insufficient data, safety data from the animal experiments and the human experiments. Even if the drug is marketed after rigorous clinical trials, we know that clinical trials are done in four phases. After the third phase, approval is given to the drug if it is successful by that level. Then it comes to the market, and after that only the effect of the drug on larger and diverse population will be seen. So the common ADRs might be detected in the early phases of animal studies or clinical trial, but the serious ADRs or the rare or less common ADRs will be detected only after marketing. Another biggest reason in the history of safety of medical use is the thalidomide tragedy. After this tragedy, the drug monitoring was divided into two eras, pre-thalidomide area and the post-thalidomide area. Thalidomide was a medicine which was marketed in Germany in 1957 for its sedative effect. The thalidomide medicine was wrongly labeled and marketed as completely safe even for pregnant women. So some of the doctors in Australia, they realized that it is having good effect in morning sickness in pregnant women. So they started prescribing it to pregnant women in 1960. And by the time 1961 ended, several infants were born with phocomelia, which is a congenital limb defect where there is deformed or shortened limbs like a flipper. Around 10,000 cases occurred, out of which 50% infants died at this spot and rest lived with a miserable life. So this was the biggest lesson from history, after which FDA became very alert and made stringent rules for the safety during the clinical trials and for the post-marketing surveillance. So if a person dies from a disease that may not be controllable by us, but if a person is dying from medicine that is unacceptable for the paramedical profession who are preparing or manufacturing the medicines. Third reason is that ADR are very expensive, because once a serious ADR occurred, the drug may be recalled from the market, which will cause a huge loss to the pharma industries who invested a lot of money and time for launching that drug. Secondly, the management of ADR related effects by the government, by the hospitals, by the patients are very costly, even costlier than the management of cardiovascular and diabetic care. Initially, drug and cosmetics were included in the pharmacovigilance program. They were monitored according to the Drug and Cosmetic Act 1940 and Drug and Cosmetic Rule 1945. But as time proceeded, blood products, biologicals, medical devices, vaccines, even medication errors, irrational use of medicines were also included. And now, since last few decades, we are having herbal medicines and traditional complementary medicines pharmacovigilance also. If we talk about herbal pharmacovigilance, its definition is similar to pharmacovigilance, but the only difference is there that we are monitoring the adverse events related to the use of herbal medicines. Now, we must know what is herbal medicine, because there are so many terms related to herbs. Herbal medicine, as per WHO, is any kind of practice or preparation that includes herbs, that is plant material, herbal preparation, finished herbal products that may include herbal extracts also. So they must be having as the active ingredient any part of plant or the product of plant or herbal extracts or combination. So then only it will be called as herbal medicine. Now, the need of herbal pharmacovigilance can be realized from the global herbal medicine market revenue generated. If we see the data, the global herbal medicine market size was around $84.5 US billion in 2019. In various forms, these herbal medicines are marketed, like tablet, capsule, powder, extract, syrups, and other types of forms. And this use has been predicted to be increasing at the CAGR rate of 20.5% during the forecast period till 2026. The herbal supplement market is still higher as compared to the herbal medicine market. And during the last few years, during the corona pandemic, we have seen a rise of 20% in the use of herbal medicines by the people across the world. If we see the Indian scenario, in India, the turnover all of herbal medicine is about ₹5.5 billion per year. So if herbal medicines are used at such a large scale, regulation regarding its safety and monitoring is definitely required. The main the reason behind the upsurge of use of herbal medicine is that people are disappointed from the current conventional therapies or the side effects of the allopathic medicines. And they believe that because herbal medicines are of natural origin, they are very effective and they are safer even for long-term usage. Second reason is that people have stopped believing their doctors. In the era of WhatsApp University and YouTube University, they want to do their own self-medications and take control of their own health. Third reason is peer influence. If a person having arthritis has used a particular herbal medicine and says that it worked for him very well, the other person having arthritis will go to the market and buy this product OTC and will start using it, will have faith in the use, even if the safety regarding that or efficacy of that product is not confirmed. So whether all the natural drugs or anything which is natural always safe, according to Acharya Charak, he said that even the most useful drug can be a poison if it is not handled properly, and any strong poison can become an excellent medicine if it is used in proper way. So it's not a matter of just natural. If herbal medicines or if any medicine is used at right dose, in the right form, at the right time, in the right patient, then it will be a medicine, and otherwise it may have the adverse drug reactions. So herbal medicines, are they really safe? So, that can be understood by the WHO database, which is having 16,000 suspected herbal ADR case reports, which are increasing day by day with the increased use of herbal medicine. So herbal drugs are safe. That is a misconception, because all effective drugs will produce adverse drug reactions, and because herbal medicines are effective, they are no exception. They may produce ADRs. And this knowledge about the adverse reactions of herbal medicines is not new. In the 18th century, when Dr. William Withering, he discovered the use of digitalis herb in treatment of dropsy that was caused by congestive cardiac failure. After 10 years, he wrote a book called An Account of Foxglove and Some of Its Medicinal Use, wherein he had mentioned that large and repeated doses of digitalis, which contains the potent chemical digitoxin and digoxin, will cause simple side effects like vomiting, giddiness, cold sweat, diuresis, confusion, blurred vision, to severe complications like heart dysrhythmia, syncope, convulsion, and death. In that book, he had mentioned all the types of method of preparation, how it digitalis leaf should be used, in what dose, what will happen if overdose happen, and how to manage the overdose and toxic effects. So the knowledge of the adverse drug reactions of herbal ingredient was already known since last century. There are more examples of unsafe herbal therapies. For example, ephedra, which is basically a Chinese drug, ma huang, and also used in Indian medicine as herbal supplement. The US market before 2003 was flooded with supplements containing ephedra, which were marketed as slimming product. They were used to decrease the body weight, and ADRs were reported due to the use of herbs. Out of all these ADRs, 64% of the ADR were caused by products which were having ephedra, because we now know that ephedra contains a sympathomimetic chemical alkaloid, which is ephedrine. So due to the fact and the severe ADR reports, which caused this increase in hypertension and cardiac arrest, In 2003, US FDA announced a ban on sale of the products and dietary supplements that contain ephedra. This was the first time in history when a herbal supplement was banned. Another example is kava, which is a Piper methysticum. This is used as most effective natural health supplement for anxiety disorder, for treatment of insomnia, and it is also used by local people for recreational purposes because of its potent chemical carvapyrones. But this chemical, if it is used in larger amounts, is reported to cause hepatotoxicity induced by them. So because of this ADR, many countries like Canada and European countries, they banned the herbal supplements containing kava, while the US FDA, they allowed the marketing of such products in US with proper labeling on the product that it should not be used for more than 4 weeks. It should not be used in previous cases of liver disorders or alcoholism or with sedative medicines, because sedative medicines will be retained for longer time in body if the liver is damaged by the hepatotoxicity, and adverse effect due to the sedatives will also happen. Till current day, the products Kava Kava herbal tea is available in market, even online. They have made provisions on the labels where they are writing the name, complete botanical name of the product or the plant which is used. They are writing the amount which is present in the herbal tea, but they are offering this disclaimer that the daily value is not established, so person should be using it at their own risk. Although directions are given that they should not exceed 3 servings per day, and the cautions are also given regarding the liver toxicity effects of kava. Another disclaimer is given at the bottom of product that these statements have not been evaluated by Food and Drug Administration and they are not intended for diagnosis, prevention and cure of any diseases. So where is the regulation here? If antipsychotic, anti-anxiety drugs which are allopathic, they are controlled by FDA under the Drug and Cosmetic Act, why anti-anxiety drug that is reported to have severe hepatotoxic effects on overdose, then why it is not regulated under the Drug and Cosmetic Act? Other examples are aristolochic acid induced renal failure. Aristolochic acids, they are nitrophenanthrin carboxylic acids which are found in Aristolochia species, which is a traditional Chinese medicine used for diuretic action and for decreasing the body weight. Consumption of Aristolochia products that caused severe renal failure in many cases. Essential oil toxicity is reported in many essential oil or volatile oil containing drugs. For example, is polygon toxicity. Polygon is a monoterpene ketone which is present in the volatile oils of menthol pollicum that was used as abortifacient. But high dose of this oil that caused hepatic failure as well as CNS toxicity and other toxic effects, including the death. So just like allopathic medicine, the reports of herbal ADRs have shown that herbal drugs may cause common ADRs varying from nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, till serious ADRs varying to hepatotoxicity, nephrotoxicity, and even neurotoxicity. Now, what are the possible causes of ADR due to herbal medicine? Many causes has been determined and the factors and risk factors are also studied through several studies. So the most common factor is the intrinsic toxicity, means the plants are having the chemicals which have toxic potential if they are not used in the proper way. For example, Datura stramonium, the aerial parts, the flowering tops as well as the leaves are prescribed as anticholinergic medicine, but the Datura seeds, they are having very high levels of tropane alkaloids, tropin and hyoscyamine around 3 to 6 milligram per 50 to 100 grams of seed. So if instead of the aerial parts, the seeds are consumed within 60 minutes of oral ingestion, cases of delirium, seizure, respiratory failure, cardiovascular collapse, and even coma are reported. And these cases, even if they are mild, they do not subside for 1 or 2 days because of the increased gastric emptying time. Another case that is observed in animals is the use of Veratrum californicum. So when the sheep, pregnant sheep, consumed Veratrum californicum on the 14th day of the gestation, the lambs which were born, they had this monkey face disorder, which is a teratogenic disorder that is attributed to the steroidal alkaloid cyclopamine present in Veratrum. Actually, Veratrum main constituent is the steroidal alkaloid protoveratrins, which were used as antihypertensives, but due to some side effects, the use was discontinued. But even in animals, because we do not control the grazing of animals, this kind of adverse effect is seen till date. Senecio is a reputed medicine which is used to treat female disorders and urinary and respiratory problems. This was also found to be hepatotoxic in humans and carcinogenic and mutagenic in animals. Due to the presence of pyrrolizidine alkaloids, which are very potent chemicals, the alkaloid which was found in this medicine was senecionin. So it caused hepatotoxicity. If we see other herbal supplements, ginkgo biloba, which is used over the counter for improving the brain function, specifically in dementia, the adverse effects, the side effects of ginkgo biloba consumption, like allergic reactions, diarrhea, dizziness, are already known. But the adverse drug reactions that happen, like intracranial hemorrhage due to decreased platelet aggregation property and increased coagulation property of the ginkgolide B, which is the chemical found in it, that is a diterpene trielecton. So the products are marketed as a health supplement or herbal supplement with the note that US FDA does not regulate the production of herbs and supplements. So you have to use it at your own risk. Another example is use of licorice. Licorice is JT mud, which contains the triterpenoidal glycoside glycyrrhizin, which is a medicine as well as a natural sweetener. The safe dose of glycyrrhizin is around 2 mg per kg body weight as per WHO. In 2005 in Italy, a case was reported where a young school-going boy was hospitalized for generalized tonic-clonic seizure, and the reason for that was not known in the beginning. Afterwards, it was realized that it happened due to constant high blood pressure, which had led to posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome, PRES. On asking the boy what he had consumed in the last few days, he said that he was eating lots of chocolate made up of licorice, which were very popular in the foreign countries. Due to that, the blood levels of glycyrrhizin had rise to 2.88 milligram in his body per kg body weight, which is higher than the safer dose as per WHO. In some countries, initially the licorice chocolates were banned, but afterwards they again came to the market with warning labels on the medicine, and still these chocolates are available. That was intrinsic toxicity due to the potent phytochemicals present in the drug. Now, extrinsic toxicity are also there, which are attributed to adulteration practices due to contamination using heavy metal chemicals like pesticides, biological contaminants, and addition of modern medicine in the herbal medicine. Let us see them one by one with example. Adulteration means mixing of similar looking substances or substandard medicines into the original drug. This practice is sometimes happening, or many times they are occurring due to the nomenclature issues, due to availability of number of vernacular names, common names, which are similar to other drugs also. For example, Artemisia annua, which is called sweet wormwood, that is containing a sesquiterpene dialectone artemisinin, which is potent anti-malarial medicine that is used to treat, that is drug of choice in falciparum malaria. That is adulterated by mistake with Artemisia absinthium. The same genus is there, but the species is different. Although the common names are quite similar, wormwood, mugwort, they contain the sesquiterpene lactone absinthin, which is, on the other hand, a neurotoxin and does not have anti-malarial effect. So it causes seizure and neurotoxic disorders. Same way, Valeriana officinalis is commonly called as garden heliotrope. It contains valpotriates, which are iridoids responsible for its sedative and muscle relaxant effect. This is widely used in many kind of herbal medicines and herbal supplements. This is wrongly substituted by Heliotropium europaeum plant, which is also commonly called as heliotrope. This is heliotrope, while valerian is called garden heliotrope, which is quite similar to the name of heliotrope. So heliotropium, it is containing pyrrolidine alkaloids, which are toxic, which are causing liver toxicity. A very classic example of mustard oil adulteration we have seen in 1998, where epidemic dropsy occurred due to neurotoxicity effect of mustard oil, which was adulterated with Argimon Mexicana, that is Darudi seed oil. 2,500 cases were reported of the toxicity, out of which 65 people had died. So because mustard seed and Argimon seeds are similar looking, the Argimon seeds were adulterated into the mustard seeds, and then the edible oil was prepared and consumed by people. So this is the biggest problem, one of the biggest problem in herbal medicine, the adulteration, intentional as well as unintentional. When it comes to nomenclature or plant name controversy, we have seen a Giloy controversy during the second wave of corona pandemic, where Giloy was highly used for immunomodulator effect in the form of Ucada or in the form of various herbal supplements or herbal medicines. One of the doctors in Mumbai, he reported 6 cases of severe liver damage, which he proved that it might have been caused by the use of Gallo. He performed some studies also and published article in journals which said that Giloy is a hepatotoxic Ayurvedic medicine. This matter was dealt very strictly with the Ayush department. They blamed the doctors for defaming the Ayurvedic medicine, and they said that probable cause of the toxicity may be due to a substitution of Tenospora cordifolia, that is the actual Giloy, with the toxic substitute Tenosporia crispa, other species of Tenosporia only. The Ministry of Ayush also tweeted regarding the safety of Giloy that it is well approved by FDA. But they gave a caution that any Ayurvedic medicine should not be consumed without the guidance from the medical practitioners. So still there is ambiguity in that, because if we see the WHO database, Vigi Access, which is easily accessible to the common public, where we can see the ADR number of reports and overview of the different types of ADR caused by any type of medicine. So if we type Guduji, which is a common name for Gado, that is Tenospora cordifolia, there are 36 reports of suspected ADR. Suspected means they are not confirmed whether they are associated with the use of Tenosporia, but people have given such kind of reports of the association. Out of the 36 cases, 18 cases are of liver damage due to Gado usage. And not only in Asian countries, other countries are also reporting, like Europe and America are also reporting such cases. These cases are not reported just now during the pandemic, but such cases have been reported since 2009. And slight rise in the cases has happened during the pandemic because the use of Garo has increased. So we must take into consideration if the reports are there about the suspected ADR, we should have some consideration regarding that. Another extrinsic factor is contamination with heavy metal. This is again the biggest reason why the herbal medicines and Ayurvedic medicines are rejected by foreign countries, because most of them, they are found to be contaminated with heavy metals like lead, mercury, arsenic and cadmium. Let us see a case report where an Australian woman aged 34 years was hospitalized due to shortness of breath, palpitation and generalized arthralgia. She was suffering from these symptoms since last 1 month, and on examination her hemoglobin level was around 6, that is severe anemia. The blood lead levels of this lady was around 105 microgram per deciliter of blood, and levels of mercury and arsenic were also detected, which were low but were also present. On questioning, the lady said that she was consuming several herbal medicines in the last 6 months to increase her fertility. When those herbal preparations were tested, they were found to have 4% weight by weight lead, 12% weight by weight mercury and arsenic, also under sufficient detectable limits, which are much higher than the allowable limit for the herbal as well as Ayurvedic products. The allowable limit, for example, as per WHO for lead is around 10 parts per million, and here it was 4% weight by weight. Other contaminations include the contamination by the chemical fertilizers and pesticides which are used during the cultivation of the herbal medicines, and the residue might remain in the herbal medicine. So the proper testing and the amount of these should be regulated in the medicine, because severe cases of cancer are reported due to these carcinogenic organophosphorus compounds. And now that is the reason why we have switched to organic farming. After heavy metals, the contamination by microbiological products or microbiological things has been reported, and due to this contamination of E. coli in the herbal medicines as well as fungal toxins in the herbal medicines, again our products are being rejected in the international market. When we see mycotoxin, the most common mycotoxin is aflatoxin, which is produced by the fungus Aspergillus. This aflatoxin is causing severe neurotoxicity. Besides Aspergillus, Penicillium and Fusarium are also producing this fungal toxins, which are causing severe mycotoxicosis. Mainly the herbal drugs, where the medicinal part which is used is growing underground, as well as the parts like nuts, they are found to be contaminated with such kind of mycotoxins. Another extrinsic factor is this addition of moderate drugs into the herbal medicine. For example, many products were studied in AIIMS. Out of the studied herbal products, 26 of the products were found to have corticosteroids. Mostly betamethasone 0.1 to 0.3 milligram is used in herbal medicine that are meant to treat eczema, rheumatoid arthritis and asthma, which then cause the ADRs. Similar way, anti-epileptic herbal medicines are found to be contaminated or deliberately adulterated with sodium valproate, phenytoin and carbamazepine. And the anti-diabetic medicines, they are also adulterated with synthetic medicines. Other indirect risk factors include wrong indication or wrong use of medicine, wrong manufacturing processes, or the herb-drug interaction. In as an example of wrong indication, we have seen ephedra, which was a potent medicine, but it was wrongly indicated for use as dietary supplement for weight reduction, and thus it caused severe adverse reactions. Wrong use of or use of wrong part of the plant is also responsible for the adverse drug reactions. As we saw the example of datura, instead of aerial parts, if the seeds are utilized in medicine, that will lead to formation of a toxic product. Another challenge which we face in herbal medicine is the management of dose, because they are herbal medicine. Because of the biological variability, the dose is not properly managed, and most of the times overdose is happening. If we see wrong manufacturing practices, garlic oil tablets which were prepared using the excipient beta-cyclodextrin for increasing the solubility of garlic in the this tablet form. This tablet was meant to be used for its cholesterol lowering effect, but when it was launched in this pharmaceutical form, this does not produce any cholesterol lowering effect. This happened because of the complexation of allicin, which is the active ingredient in garlic, with beta-cyclodextrin, and thus it did not cause the complete release of allicin, and thus there was lack of the efficacy. So here in ADR reporting, this kind of ADRs are also reported as lack of efficacy or lack of or miss formation of the pharmaceutical preparation. If we see examples of wrong processing practices, aconite, which is a poisonous plant that is used in homeopathic medicine because of its toxic effect. But if we see the literature, we will find many ways to decrease the toxicity of aconite and use it in herbal medicine also. The toxic effects of aconite are attributed to the diester diterpenoid alkaloid aconitin, which can be reduced to its low toxic analogs monoester diterpenoid alkaloids by heating process or by prescribing them with the licorice. So because we are having lack of knowledge about how to manage the toxicity, we are not able to manage and toxicity happens. Herb-drug interactions are again causing different types of ADR when the herbs are prescribed with the synthetic medicines. In a case report, two patients who were taking phenytoin for treatment of their epilepsy, they suddenly reported that the seizures are not being controlled even after use of phenytoin. After close examination, they revealed that they were using Ayurvedic syrups Pushpi for their brain stimulation along with the phenytoin. So there was a herb drug interaction where Shang Pushpi decreased the concentrations of phenytoin in the body, and hence the loss of seizure control happened. There are many cases of herb drug interactions which are now well established. The most common among them are interaction of garlic and ginkgo with anticoagulant drugs like warfarin as well as aspirin. So when these drugs are prescribed together, this may lead to severe bleeding, hemorrhage, and death due to hemorrhage. Same way, when licorice is prescribed with corticosteroid medicines, it will increase the concentration of corticosteroids in the body, thus leading to adverse effects of corticosteroids. A classic example is use of the herbal supplement St. John's Wort, which is Hypericum. This was used as antidepressant herbal supplement. This, when given with oral contraceptive or hormone therapy, caused the failure of the contraceptive therapy because of the herb drug interaction. Same way, when Senna, Cascara, Psyllium, they are given along with other medicines, they cause decrease in their absorption and lack of efficacy. We are well aware about piperine, which is present in piperlongum, and black pepper, which is enhancing the bioavailability of several drugs, including beta blockers, propranolol, and thiophylline. So these interactions may lead to increase of the dosage or the availability of the synthetic medicine, which can thereby cause the adverse drug reactions. Now, the grapefruit toxicity or interactions are reported in India. It was very common in foreign countries, but now in India also it is occurring, because grapefruit juice that contains that increase the oral bioavailability of several medicines, because it binds with the liver enzymes and increase the concentration by decreasing the metabolism of these medicines. The juice is also having high levels of potassium. So if it is given to patients with kidney damage, it will not be excreted properly and will lead to adverse drug reactions due to accumulation in the body. The grapefruit juice is also highly acidic, and it will worsen the case of heartburn and cause gastroesophageal reflux if it is consumed by the patient with acidity disorders. Now, what are the challenges in the safety monitoring of herbal medicines? As we have seen, errors in preparation, which are caused by ambiguity in the nomenclature due to the geographical variation in the active constituent of the plants, in variation in the climatic conditions where they are growing, in the variation in the method of preparation. So quality control of herbal medicine is very difficult, so leading to difficulty in its safety monitoring also. Controlling the adulteration and contamination of herbal medicine is very difficult. Many a times herbal medicines are multiple ingredient formulations. So again, controlling one drug is difficult, and controlling multiple drugs which may produce interaction is even more difficult. Another challenge is that herbal medicines are mostly prescribed or non-prescription medicines, which can be taken over the counter, and it is promoting the self-medication, where the person is not reporting to a doctor that he is consuming these herbal medicine while taking any allopathic medicine. This is leading to several kinds of unpredictable interactions between herb drug, and even herb and food. There is lack of inclusion of all the herbal medicines in pharmacopoeia, although Indian herbal pharmacopoeia and Ayurvedic pharmacopoeia have included many medicines, but many local herbal medicines which are widely used in particular places, they are not included in the pharmacopoeias. There is limited pharmacological data regarding the safety and toxicity profile of herbal medicines. There is lack of awareness regarding the ADRs of herbal medicine. So people do not report the ADR. So underreporting happens, and therefore we do not get awareness about the ADR caused by a particular medicine. There is disparity in the regulation of herbal medicine at an international level, because in some countries the herbal medicines are marketed as prescription medicine. In other countries, they are controlled as herb supplements or non-prescription medicines. There is inadequate or lenient licensing scheme. If anyone wants to do the business of herbal medicine, they will label their medicine as dietary supplement or herbal supplement, and then the safety and monitoring of that drug will not be compulsory for them. Most of the herbs since 1994 have been included in dietary supplement, and they are regulated by the Dietary Supplement Health and Education Act, which does not make compulsion that all the safety and monitoring data should be presented before marketing the drug. So if we see supplements, they are there are herbal drugs which are marketed as supplements, but they are having biologically active potent ingredients, potent phytochemicals in them. Unlike this conventional medicines, these supplements are not permitted to market for the purpose of treating a disease. They are meant for prevention of disease or for nutrition purpose. FDA is not authorized to review the dietary supplement safety and effectiveness. Manufacturers of the dietary supplements or herbal supplements, they just have to stick to some of the GMP requirements and labeling requirements. They have to ensure that they are not adulterated, but the safety monitoring of the herbal medicine when they are marketed as supplement is not strict. So if we see valerian, which is marketed as health supplement for sedative effects, there are 240 herbal drug interactions caused by valerian with other synthetic medicines, out of which 3 are major, 239 are moderate, and none are minor. So if this is marketed as dietary supplement, how we will regulate these kind of interactions and the toxicity produced by so many interactions? ADR related to consumption of methi seeds are reported in Morocco, where the pregnant woman who consumed methi seeds during the first trimester of their pregnancy gave birth to infant with spina bifida, which is a defect in vertebra where there is protuberance of the spinal nerve. So this is attributed to the use of methi seeds by the Moroccan ladies. However, the correlation between the use of methi seed and the disease has not been proven, but there is a suspicion regarding that. So if we are using methi as food, as dietary supplement, then where is the regulation and who will monitor the effects produced by them? There was a curious case of Anandeya Poshan, the mysterious COVID cure during the second wave of COVID-19, where an Ayurvedic practitioner in Andhra Pradesh called Anandeya, he marketed concoction of several herbal medicine as Ayurvedic products. He was giving paste, he was giving decoctions as well as eye drops. And especially for eye drops, he had claimed that using these drops will increase the oxygen levels in the patient's body. And the people crowded, even the corona patients crowded for the collection of these medicines. After one lot was over, after distribution, Ayush department interfered the distribution of this medicine and they stopped the distribution till the reports of safety comes. After this testing by ICMR and Ayush team. After testing, the Ayush team declared that this concoction cannot be called as Ayurvedic medicine because it is not following the preparation protocols of Ayush. So it is some kind of traditional local medicine and thus it does not need any license for its free marketing. Although the commissioner also said that it does not contain harmful ingredients, so we can promote its use into herbal medicine or into COVID. So when we see pharmacovigilance of herbal remedies, they are done according to the pharmacovigilance of conventional drug. Okay. Although herbal medicines scenario is different from the conventional medicines, we are doing the monitoring of them similar to the conventional allopathic medicines. Some adaptations have been made for herbals in some countries where they are monitoring herbals separately, but in India, we do not have a separate adaptation for herbal medicine. We have separate adaptation for ASU and H medicines, Ayurvedic, Siddha, Yunani, and homeopathic medicine, but not for the herbal medicines that are not falling under the purview of Ayurvedic medicines. WHO has implemented a uniform HATC classification, that is herbal, anatomical, therapeutical, chemical classification, for combating with the nomenclature issues and adulteration issues due to nomenclature of herbal medicine. So according to that, the reporting of herbal medicine should be done in the form of Latin name, the binomial names only, and not the vernacular names. So the monitoring of herbal medicine, the pharmacovigilance, is controlled by the international authorities, World Health Organization, WHO, and Uppsala Monitoring Center under WHO, along with the ICH, International Conference of Harmonization, and SIOMS, Council for International Organization of Medical Sciences. Some European countries and Japanese countries, they are also regulating or offering the regulation in the clinical trials and safety monitoring of conventional as well as herbal medicine. So WHO had launched this International Drug Monitoring Program, WHO PIDM, in 1968, where WHO headquarters situated at Geneva were collecting information from the various countries who became a member of WHO regarding the adverse drug reactions of all the medicines. After 10 years, in 1978, WHO formulated a WHO collaborating center at Uppsala in Sweden, which was called as Uppsala Monitoring Center, UMC. This monitoring center is coordinating with all the national centers of various countries and maintaining a database called VigiBase, which is having suspected ADR reports and individual case report files of different ADRs. Currently, 28 million ADR reports are there in the VigiBase database. If we see the scenario in India, although the pharmacovigilance of all types of medicine, including herbal medicine, was started in 1986, but a proper pharmacovigilance program of India, PVPI, was launched in 2010. The India had become the full member of WHO program for international drug monitoring in 1998 itself. The goal of PVPI is to support the WHO's international drug monitoring this program and to ensure the safety and efficacy of medicine and for early detection of ADRs. Currently, the PVPI on behalf of India is the ninth largest contributor globally in terms of submitting the ICSR, that is individual case safety report, to WHO monitoring center. So it is contributing a lot by timely submission of the ADR reports to the Uppsala monitoring center. If we see the hierarchy of the regulation in India under PVPI program, the Directorate General of Health Services under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, has formulated Central Drug Standard Control Organization, CDC-SCO, having its headquarters in New Delhi for the regulatory aspects of all the medicines, under which there are six zonal and seven sub-zonal offices at various places, including Ahmedabad in Gujarat. Under that, we are having the National Coordination Center, NCCIP, situated at Indian Pharmacopeial Commission, Ghaziabad, that is responsible for monitoring or communicating all the data to the Uppsala Monitoring Center. Under that, we are having ADR monitoring centers situated at various medical colleges across the country. Currently, since 2017, the IPC has been announced to be the WHO Collaborating Center for Pharmacovigilance in Public Health Program and Regulatory Services, which is good for India. Now, what should be reported when it comes to reporting of ADR? Any suspected ADR, including the minor one, should be reported. So even if the patient or the healthcare professional is not sure about the relationship between the ADR and the drug, he or she should be reporting the ADR to the database. All kinds of serious, unexpected, unusual ADR should be reported. All kinds of effects or interactions due to herb drug, herb food interaction should be reported. Any kind of ADRs produced due to misuse, abuse, or drug withdrawal should be reported. All types of medication errors should be reported. All types of pharmaceutical defects or lack of efficacy problems should be reported. Off-label use means mislabeling issues should also be reported to the ADR monitoring centers. Who can report? Any person can report the ADR, including the consumers, the patient, the relative of patient, or the patient caretakers. But we prefer that healthcare professionals or the patient through healthcare professionals should be reporting the ADR at the ADR monitoring center. Healthcare professionals include the physicians, dentists, pharmacists, radiologists, radiographers, nurses, and others. The industry should also report. They may directly report to the National Coordinator Coordinating Center, IPC. Other authorities, drug regulatory authorities or medical authorities can also report the ADR. When it should be reported? All the suspected ADR should be reported as soon as possible to the ADR monitoring center. The spontaneous cases should be, however, reported within the 10 days. If there is a case of serious ADR leading to death, that should be reported as soon as possible. But preferable is that we report serious ADR within 24 hours and up to 7 days to the NCC, National Coordinator Center, IPC. Non-serious cases can be reported by anyone within 30 days. The PVPI says that reporting delay may create serious problem. Even if you are not sure, do the over-reporting because the reports will be analyzed, the risk-benefit analysis will be done. So you should not be afraid of reporting if you are not sure. Do report even if you are not sure. How the reporting is to be done? Under PVPI, the reporting system had been made very easy. All the suspected ADR should be reported through ADR reporting forms for healthcare professionals and consumers, which are available from the websites of IPC and CDCSEO. The forms are also available in 10 vernacular languages followed in India, so that even a common person can report ADR and language does not become the barrier for them to report it. PVPI helpline phone numbers, which are toll-free, are given. Mobile applications have also been launched, which is called as ADR PVPI. Email IDs are given where person can fill up the form and mail it, or even directly mail the issue or the ADR to the national authorities. Recently, in March 2021, CDCSEO has launched Sugam portal through which online reporting of the ADR can be done to CDCSEO also. This is the ADR reporting form for suspected adverse drug reaction reporting of India. Here the information regarding the patient, regarding the suspected ADR, regarding the patient history, his general health, regarding the information of medicine that the person had taken, and information of the herbal medicine which he might be taking along with the drug. Such kind of informations are required. There is also a blue, this is a red colored form, and the reporting in this form should be done by the healthcare professionals. The common public can be reporting this ADRs through a blue colored form, which is available in different vernacular languages. Now, whom to report? The reporting can be done basically at the ADR monitoring centers established in various hospitals. Although pharmaceutical industries and national regulatories can monitor or report these ADR at the NCC-IPC. After the drug has been, ADR has been reported to the AMC, the AMCs analyze that data and they enter it into a software called VigiFlow. Through that software, the information will reach to the